Okay, is this working?
Yeah, seems so. Audio is okay.
Okay,
let's talk about upgrades.
Welcome to our talk, Rule Breaker, upgrading an OpenStack cloud while skipping a release. We, that is my colleague Rick Zalewski, and me, Nano Krinner. And we are both cloud engineers working on the SUSE OpenStack Cloud product. Okay, we will start with some general remarks about upgrades and shortly discuss some common upgrade strategies. And then we will come to the more interesting part where we describe how we did an upgrade while skipping an OpenStack release. And in the end, we will finish with a short outlook on where we want to go next. Yeah, so who in this room has actually already done an OpenStack upgrade? Yeah, it's quite a few. Yeah, it's actually an important topic. So yeah, there is a reason why to upgrade. For example, if you want to have access to security fixes or to stability or performance improvements that got added to the project during the development cycle. Some people just want to closely follow the upstream development and have access to new features. And of course, it's always good to stay on a supported release. But probably not so many people have enjoyed the upgrade experience so far. Yeah, with an upgrade, there are always some problems coming, like downtime that's hard to avoid and always an issue. An upgrade needs a lot of preparation that starts with writing announcements or coordinating all interested parties. A lot of testing is required. After the upgrade, existing workflows probably need to get adjusted. And with yeah, the new code, there's always the chance to have new bugs in its deployment. And in the worst case, we can even have data loss or corrupted databases, for example. Yeah, that's why upgrades are not always fun. From the product side, we also see from our customers topics coming up again and again when we are talking about upgrades. Of course, they have even more emphasis on reducing the downtime. And in the best case, they would like to have a live upgrade and a better the possibility to roll back after an or in an upgrade, during an upgrade, especially if it failed. And that's possible already now, but it's not very easy to do. Customers also, they want to have a clear documentation on what is happening during an upgrade, and that needs to be created. And yeah, that's why quite some people want to not upgrade to every release, but skip one or more if it's possible. So as outlined in the previous slides, yeah, what we see out there, there is something we call the upgrade marathon. That is when a new release comes out. It first is being evaluated by all the interested parties. Then starts a phase where the upgrade is planned and tested, and that can go through many iterations. And after some point, finally, the upgrade is executed. And after that, there still usually will need to be done some adjustments for things that got missed during the testing. And the new features, if they are there, if they want to get used, they need to integrate it. And with the 6-month release cycle, there's yeah, often the next release is already there, and you could start over again with everything. Yeah, so people are tempted to just, maybe not this time, just not do the upgrade at some point. Yeah, and as we can see on that graph that we took from the recent OpenStack user survey, at any given time, there's lots of old OpenStack releases still out there in production deployments. So obviously, many people don't do the upgrades. They avoid it. And yeah, as a consequence, users have to live with unsupported deployments. They have to manually backport patches. They have to delay services that are depending on the cloud, on the OpenStack cloud. And if they finally decide to do the upgrade, then yeah, they are, find themselves on a dead end because the upgrade is only supported to the next OpenStack release. Yeah, and there's no clear upgrade path available. So yeah, let's look at some common upgrade strategies. There is a way that we call the official upgrade process, that is how it's described in the operator's manual, where you always upgrade to the next release, but with a release cycle of 6 months. So upgrades are required regularly, and that comes with a high maintenance cost. Unexpected changes can break the upgrade, of course. Everybody has seen that. It requires lots of manual effort because there is little automation. And users and operators have to suffer the upgrade pain regularly, and that's also a drain on the staffing. Another approach that to minimize the upgrade problems is continuous deployment. That's quite risky, and it needs a lot of development manpower and extensive testing and, of course, debugging, because often things won't go like expected, but on the upside, you are running always the latest and greatest code, and you're not doing big upgrades, but smaller incremental changes. And this might work for development deployments probably, but yeah, in productive environments, I don't want to do that probably. A cleaner approach is to just start from scratch again with a new release and roll out a fresh deployment. Yeah, but that requires lots of duplicated work. Users have to be set up again, for example, depending on the way you're doing it, or images. On the plus side, you'll get rid of outdated artifacts like abandoned instances. And a variant of that is to run a parallel installation where you move, where you just set up new controllers and then move the compute nodes, change the API endpoints, and migrate the compute nodes after that. But there you need redundant hardware. And yeah, depending on the many deployment frameworks and strategies, there is lots of very scenario-specific and tool-specific and handmade, hand-tailored solutions also for different upgrades. Okay, so as we have seen, upgrades, they are not that easy to do, and customers were asking for ways to avoid it. So we started developing a way to upgrade less frequently with skipping a release. And how we did that, I will hand over to Rick for him to explain that.
Yes, so let's start with a high-level overview. So what we did, we upgrade our product directly from Juno to Liberty. So this is a multi-step process with some steps on the old cloud and some steps on the new installed cloud. And we didn't want to achieve now that the cloud is still functional between this. We just wanted to upgrade. So the cloud is in between not fully functional. And what we also wanted to do is we wanted to upgrade the operating system along with the OpenStack release, that the customer can also use the newest operating system. So our idea behind this complete process was we wanted more like an orchestrated reinstallation. An orchestrated reinstallation just to avoid as much downtime as possible. As I said already, we wanted to ignore the OpenStack kilo release, and we wanted a way how we can handle all the missed migrations. And also to avoid much downtime, we wanted a configuration file management system where we can prepare already a lot of steps before. And as I said already, our upgrade way has still downtime, is still destructive. And yeah, and another goal was we don't want to use extra hardware. We wanted the hardware which the customer already has. For this, we have some requirements. So there needs to be an orchestration mechanism. This can be human, a script, or a configuration management system like Chef, Puppet, Ansible, or all the others. All this reduces downtime. Another requirement is the new OpenStack packages needs to be already available and tested. For the upgrade itself, there is some more space on the disk space on the controller node needed. This is mostly because we have in between and more like a duplicate database. So we dump the database, and depends how big the database is. This can be a lot of gigabyte, terabit. We highly recommend that the Nova Compute data is on a shared disk. Otherwise, it can take hours, days, when not weeks, to copy all the Nova Compute data around. So let's start with the preparation. Firstly, stop your configuration management system. There should be no changes anymore on the running cloud. Then you can start with your preparations. What you do first, update your OpenStack configurations to the new release. So take your old configurations, migrate it to the new ones. This can take a lot of time. Between two releases, there's a lot of changes in the configurations. So take your time, test all the stuff. And then you should check which special migrations was just needed for one release. This is also important. While all this, your cloud is fully functional, you have no downtime. The next step is we need to back up all our old data. So first, disable all your OpenStack services, but not stop them. This is needed to avoid random restarts when a node reboots or what else happens. Then we need to shut down all the OpenStack services on non-database nodes. When this is done, we need to dump the OpenStack database and save it external. Another point is take backups from all your important data. At any point, something can go wrong. So backup everything. When you have all your backups, then you can shut down your complete OpenStack environment and proceed to the next step. Next step would be set up the new OpenStack cloud. So if you want to upgrade your operating system, reinstall your nodes with the new operating system and install the new OpenStack packages on the nodes. When this process is done, you can start your configuration management system and synchronize all your configurations to the nodes. When this process is also done, you can start your database service and restore all your backup data. So restore your database dump into the database and mount the shared Nova Compute data into the Nova Compute nodes. Then the most difficult part is migrating the OpenStack services. You need to run all migrations. You can do it as documented for one release, but when you did some research, you will see there is some special migrations between the releases. So for example, from Juno to Liberty, we had just one issue, which was Nova. So we needed to make a special migration there. So first what we did there, we migrated the kilo to the migration level of kilo. The last kilo migration level was 290, so we just executed Nova managed DB sync --version 290. Then the data, the kilo, the Nova kilo data, the Nova data was on the kilo release. And after this, there was a special command needed, which migrates the flavor data. This was required to port this from kilo to Liberty. Yeah, this took some time, and then when this was done, we could just execute it. No one managed to be market flavor data. And the last step for this is we just need to migrate Nova to the Liberty release. It's just executing Nova manage DB sync. And then Nova is also on the last migration level. When this is done, we finalize our upgrade. So this means start all OpenStack services and check if everything is running. So this should mean your cloud is up with the new release and it should be fully functional again. For sure, we had some issues. First, the configuration file migration took a lot of time. There was so many differences between the releases. Then to figure out which migrations are missed in between and if is really everything properly migrated took also some time. Another big issue was what we do is all or nothing. You cannot just upgrade one service or one node. It's just not possible. When you start, you need to finish it. There is no way back. And this process is like more like a predefined way. This is just, in this case, applicable from Juno to Liberty. It is not automatically, does not automatically work for every other release. Yeah, so you should definitely do backups as often as possible and from everything. Then test your new configurations to avoid that you have typos in it or missed something or misconfigured something. So far we hit no issues with this way, but every setup is different and every environment is different. So there is not everything is 100% sure that it works. Yeah, these are a lot of steps, but you can automate it. For example, in our product, we have 10 steps with 3 steps on the old cloud and 7 on the new cloud, but only 5 of them are really OpenStack related where the customer needs to interact. Of course, there's happens much in the background, but we can really automate most of this. Yeah, what we want in the future, what we want to achieve in the future. For our next release, we plan a seamless upgrade, also with skipping a release, and we want to have no downtime of important services. Not for the next release, but for the next releases, we plan to revert upgrades, and we also plan better orchestration. Better orchestration is required to have a seamless upgrade. To make this process a lot easier, there can be stuff done on the OpenStack side. First, configuration files should be upgradable. Can be automatically. What would be perfect when there's a tool where you just call on the configuration and the output is the new configuration. It can show the obsolete entries when it's possible, migrate them to the new ones, and check if there can be security improvements, and when there are new entries can be added automatically. What also would be nice, uniform configuration files. So for example, the keystone part in the configuration should be always the same and not different for every project. Another good point what can be improved is when the migration tools or commands stays in the future releases and not get dropped in the next release. This avoids all the backporting and forwardporting. There is a rollback option in way in OpenStack, but this is very difficult, so this can also be improved. What's already worked on is non-destructive upgrades. So we recommend that every OpenStack project should use also versioned objects. So this makes the data model independent of the API version and the database version. Yes, so time for questions. Can you use the microphone?
You talked about orchestration. So have you, validated tools like maybe M collectives for doing this, upgrade?
We use for our product Chef,
okay,
which does all the orchestration.
Oh, okay.
I actually had a lot of questions on this presentation, but one thing that comes to mind is you mentioned the Nova data on shared storage. Can you explain what do you mean by Nova data on shared storage?
So the Nova data is stored on a disk, so all the VMs and so on. And when you want to do live migration, you also need a kind of shared disk between all the Nova compute nodes.
You mean the Nova, the VMs run on shared storage? Is that what you?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So I'm just curious, what was like the size of your team and what kind of timeline did you like plan, and did it go longer than you expected or shorter, like 1 month, 3 months?
Our team is currently between, I think, 20 or 30 people. And sure, we hit some issues, but we finished in the time we had.
So we are developing the solution. We are not running a production OpenStack cloud.
So during your kind of testing framework, what was the most difficult thing that prevents you from nicely, seamlessly upgrading, like a DB schema change or something, some configuration formatting change? What is the kind of most difficult thing, typically?
The most difficult part at the moment is having the old services running and the new services running at the same time. So we cannot just run the old cloud and the new cloud at the same API endpoints. So we need to switch, have a seamless switch, which is not possible yet.
So then for the computer side, you had a separate pool that completely brand new, and then over there you're migrating, or just using existing computing pool when you're migrating?
In between, our cloud is completely offline. So we have the old cloud, have backup the data, and then we restore the data in the new cloud.
Oh, so it's not about like upgrading against the existing computing pool. It's
yeah.
Not.
No.
Okay. I think it's more interesting to do that because, you know, some cases we don't have such a facility or luxury that we build out entire new data center again. No, it's like we already have, let's say, 10,000 computer nodes, and we try to upgrade OpenStack, then we have to use the existing one, right?
Yeah, but upgrading, this may work when you upgrade from one release to the next release without problems, but when you skip releases, then you have a lot of more problems when you just upgrade to the next release.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
What was the network topology which you tried out? You have what kind of mechanism drivers you used on this particular testing?
I think we tested it with all that are common. Actually, I don't know.
Okay.
Did you face any DB schema inconsistencies? Like, for example, if when you upgraded Neutron, I think from Havana to Kilo, you have all the Alembic scripts that exist for upgrading. Okay, but from Liberty on, the base level is Kilo. So when you upgraded from Juno to Liberty straight, did you see any database inconsistent, like missing columns or those kind of issues?
So between When you skip the kilo release, so when you upgrade directly from Juno to Liberty, we didn't hit this issue for Neutron.
You didn't hit, or you?
We didn't.
Okay. Thank you.
So just to answer the question about the network topology, SUSE OpenStack Cloud is actually pretty flexible about that, and so I don't know exactly what kind of network topology you had in mind, but everything that is supported by SUSE OpenStack Cloud can be upgraded with what they described. So as long as it's supported. So not sure what you meant with network topology, to be honest. So in terms of backends, okay. So we support OVS, Linux Bridge, VMware, and Cisco, and so on. And yeah, we can upgrade all of that.
Okay, so I think that's it. So thank you for your attention. And yeah, have a nice day.